everybody. It is my honor to introduce our next speaker, John Lovell. John is CEO and founder of the Warrior Poet Society, a values-based community dedicated to physical protection, the pursuit of truth, and living for higher purpose. John is a war veteran and a former member of Special Operations, having served in the 2nd Ranger Battalion with numerous combat tours in both Iraq and Afghanistan. He also served as a Christian missionary in Central America. John is a family man and fills his time with faith, family, fun, and study, and he enjoys a good dad joke. Please join me in welcoming John Lovell.
That's a great greeting, you know. I walked out and I was primed, ready to just dive into speech, and y'all got me all distracted with how amped up you were. On your feet, chanting America, USA. I wanted to turn around, I looked for a flag, salute it, sing the Star Spangled Banner. I don't know. Have y'all seen?
Right there.
Yeah, there it is, right there. Awesome, very good. So I've entitled my speech today, Courageous Virtue to My Fellow Outlaws. So it's going to be like that today. Sound good? I was taught in school to obey the rules. My parents taught me the same, and virtually every authority figure echoed the same sentiment. Follow the rules, right, John? Now I have two sons, and I'm teaching them to obey the rules. They're very different. You know, my youngest son, not really a rule follower. Kind of does. Like, there's rules, but I kind of want the cookie anyway. My oldest son, though, is a rule follower. And I am struggling because I have to teach my sons two very different lessons. My youngest son, I need to teach him to obey the rules. But my older son, who already is a rule follower, I have to teach him how to break them. And that may sound really weird. All the parents are kind of like, what are you doing? You're supposed to be home team parent here, all in the same light. Don't teach him to break rules. I'm like, no, follow me here. In a world full of evil and tyranny, where a lot of times bad men make bad rules, good men refuse to follow them. Can't always follow the rules. Some of the rules are bad. Some of them are evil. And I need courageous little warrior poets ready to submit to God's will over that of tyrants. There's a time and place to break the rules. And so, whereas some folks would call you outlaws for such, I'd salute you as fellow virtuous and courageous outlaws. You hear me? This was really hit home when I met a man named Farset in Greece. This was like a month ago. I was in Greece. And this unassuming, kind of skinny guy, he's humble, you know, kind of slooped down a little bit. But I talked to him, and out of all the monuments and cool, ancient, you know, temples and architecture I saw in Greece, the thing that profoundly hit me the most was this man's testimony. I want to give you just a little piece of it. He was an Iranian fighter, a soldier, you know, so not on our team, mind you. His parents and grandparents were high up in the Ayatollah, so these guys hated Christians. They would have hated you, and they hate me for sure. There's just one problem, as Farset was really fast-tracking, filling in the shoes of his forebears. One horrible thing happened to him. He converted to Christianity, something that completely caught him off guard. And Farset, not one to be bullied, starts evangelizing all these Muslim war fighters. That didn't go well for him. He was imprisoned, and for 2 years, he was tortured mercilessly. All of his bones broken, and as I got to know him better, I noticed his even mobility was really hampered. He couldn't lift his arms up. Met him outside of a pool, and so he's all just scarred up and battered until he was finally sentenced to die. His family showed up days before his execution with a suitcase full of cash. And went to his jailers and offered them this cash as long as they would allow them the opportunity to kill their son, who had been an embarrassment. That's the idea. I won't belabor you with how the miraculous process unfolded of how Farset would be liberated and just this miraculous story. And now he's a full-time missionary to most dangerous parts on earth, carrying the gospel. Farset's a good man, good man. But he certainly wasn't a rule follower. He broke all the rules of his parents, of his religion, of his country, sentenced and condemned to die. And it cost him something horribly personal. Freedom from tyrants means disobedience, guys. It's enshrined in our very Declaration of Independence. I want to read Jefferson's words to you. When a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same object, evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government. A modern paraphrase goes like this: when tyranny becomes law, rebellion becomes duty. Martin Luther King Jr. would say something similar in these words. He says, one has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws. I want to be rule followers when the rules are good. I want to be a rule breaker when the rules are bad. And I noticed that our most basic freedoms are under attack. You've been hearing from dynamic speakers the same. I don't think I have to do much to convince you guys in this room that the First Amendment is under terrible attack. The right to just free assembly, especially during the pandemic, as we were... just thought I'd slip that in there, but you guys are quick. Y'all are like, ah, see what he did there. I see what he did. Right to assemble, right to free speech. In some places in Europe and Canada, you can immediately get jailed. You can get ostracized. You can get fined just for saying the wrong thing. And you guys feel that pressure as well. Family get-togethers and groups of friends, what you say and don't say on one of the big tech platforms that I don't want to name because I don't want to give them an attaboy. You know, I'm pretty ticked at big tech for their complicity in eliminating First Amendment freedoms and illegal discriminatory activities toward conservative ideals. You can tell I've thought about that before. Like, he said that before. I'm like, yeah, I'm mad. I'm mad about it. That's right. Freedom of religion absolutely has been attacked for decades. Freedom of the press, it's hard to find a news story that I don't immediately lean in and be like, yeah, but what's the real story? What's really happening? I don't really trust much of my news sources anymore. I'm a Second Amendment advocate, and so I'd go and show you for the last decades, this has been under attack because the only way to really strip a person of all their liberties is to make sure you disarm them. It's kind of the fail-safe. If people are well-armed, you can't enslave them. You can only push them to a point, and then things get bloody. It's the only fail-safe of a dying republic. First Amendment gives you all the good stuff that's worth living for. The Second Amendment makes sure you keep it all. That's what the deal is. And as a Second Amendment guy, as a former soldier, as a freedom fighter, as a warrior poet, that's my deal. I carry guns everywhere I go, every day of my life. Not because I feel like somebody wants to take a run at me, but I feel like if something went down on my watch, I would be able to defend and protect life. That's the deal. I love people. I want to defend people, and that's what amps me up, protecting good people from bad people. But that's not even what the Second Amendment is necessarily about. I can defend myself. I can help defend the public good as a lover of people. But it's about protecting ourselves from tyrants. And I want you to understand, as we're weighing into really a point that's arriving us at what rules to follow and what rules to disobey, the cost of losing something like a Second Amendment, which is constantly under attack now more than ever, and worse is yet to come. I want to play a game called Ask an Empire. Sound fun? Say yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Very good. Ask an Empire. The Ottoman Empire, that's modern-day Turkey, in 1911 instituted a full gun confiscation. Now, a few years later, from 1915 to 1917, 1.5 million Armenians, out of 2.5 million, that's about 40% of all Armenians, were murdered by their government. We call it the Armenian Holocaust. And you don't get taught it in schools because our schools suck. Not yours. Yours is great, though. That's the Ottoman Empire. The Soviet Union, 1929, under Joseph Stalin, instituted a strict gun control. policy, and tens of millions were murdered, imprisoned, or put in forced labor camps. Germany, gun control was instituted in 1938 under Adolf Hitler. 10 million Germans, particularly from minority classes, were wiped out. China, under Mao Zedong in 1935, approximately 65 million Chinese were murdered by their government in the government's zeal to create a new socialist Chinese utopia. It's always for your good, for your good, for your safety, for your protection. We'll take your guns. It's all horse crap. It is. 6,000 Native Americans on the Trail of Tears would say, don't give this government your guns. It's already happened on our continent. Guys, never, ever, ever give up your guns. And there's going to be a cost of that disobedience. And frankly, here I'm in D.C. and I was walking around this morning a little miffed because D.C. has such horrible gun laws already. And here we're in the bastion of kind of like the nursing place of freedom, of where our country was really grown up. And here's the place where my constitutional rights are supposed to be protected at the forefront, yet I can't carry a gun here. And that just seems such an ironic disconnect at the base of all these edifices, these monuments to freedom, that I was standing at them in awe at them. And I was thinking, you know, maybe freedom was nursed here as an infant, but now it's like freedom is being nursed here in hospice. It's like freedom's may have been grown here, but it's dying here too. You bunch of backstabbing coward lawmakers. I'm not a politician, so I don't really care. I don't need your vote. And you're like, that's not politically correct. I'm like, I'm not a politician. I just say whatever I want to say, and then hopefully they'll invite me back one day. If not, it'll be all right. I'm still going to just say the truth plainly because I'm just so sick of being bullied, especially over the last few years with all the fear-mongering. They want you afraid. You realize that? Whether it's an energy crisis, security crisis, it's a safety, public health crisis, energy crisis, 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 crisis. And the idea is freak you out so you give more power to your ruling betters. That's the idea. They want you scared. So I wanted to move in and say, given that disobedience is a natural response to tyranny, disobedience will cause you personal pain. Because I know what you're thinking. It's what I hope as well. It's that somebody else will solve our problem. It's like, oh, freedom's under attack. And then you look at like, what heroic champion will win it back for me while I do TikTok stuff? You Generation Zers know I don't TikTok, right? I did that. That was for you. That was for you. I don't know. I don't do the TikTok stuff. But anyway, of like, who will pay this for me? And unfortunately, as we've been nursed in the breadbasket of the world for far too long without any personal skin put in it, I'll say the hour is too late. Freedom is going to cost you something personally if you want to keep it. So let's play a game of Imagine now. We did Ask an Empire game, and none of the other speakers played games with you, all right? And I'm the first one. How about a round of applause for me? You guys are awesome. Y'all are my favorite. That's great. So let's play a game of Imagine. Imagine that a new lab-grown virus is created by your ruling betters in the means to seize massive swaths of power and cash at your freedom's expense. You're not allowed to go outside anymore. Can't go to church anymore. Can't meet with your friends anymore. You got to cover up your face. And so that is going to happen again. I traveled during the corona thing to 26 different states and 7 countries during corona. I traveled all the time. That's not an applause moment. I'm just saying, hey, I gathered a lot of data I remember my family and I walking through Washington, D.C. airport, and we walked for like 30 minutes, and we were the only ones unmasked for the whole time. I know you're supposed to mask. I don't care. I'm not doing it anymore. I'm not playing the little charade. We're like a year and a half in, and the jig was up, but we weren't really afraid of the virus anymore. We were just afraid of each other getting upset at each other, so we're like, oh, do the mask. And I'm like, nope, I'm not doing it. I can't. And I was like, ugh. I got that like fire in your bones, Jeremiah thing. I'm like, no, I can't do it. I'm not gonna do it. I'm tired of being bullied. No, come at me, bro. I was awful to fly with because I kept making scenes and stuff. But I'm like, man, what I couldn't shake people awake to understand is that, the virus wasn't the big thing to be afraid of. It was the encroaching authoritarianism that was masking us and silencing us and bullying us. And it only works if you go along with it. And I'm so like, take the stupid mask. Do you even, your nose is hanging out. Your nose is out. Everyone's nose is out. You know? You don't believe in any of this stuff. I didn't mean to rant on Corona. I'm gonna rant on Corona some more. You know, you're all like 6 feet distancing until you get onto a plane because Delta cares a lot about, you know, germs until it's time to make a profit. And so they pack you in like sardines. So you're like 6 feet away from 16 people. And you got a mask, you know, until it's time for snack time. And then the virus won't get you because it respects your need to eat. And that is really, really awesome of it. So let's imagine that a new one of these viruses comes out to punk you all out. This go round, are you ready to lose friends? You're ready to strain family relationships this time. It is more rhetorical. I do like the stuff like, oh yeah. So if you want to do that, I won't inhibit you from it. Remember, freedom, yeah, outlaw. So if I told you not to, and then you did it anyway, you're kind of getting my speech. You know, so don't do it. Best crowd ever. What if they find you? I just preached at a church out in California that refused to shut down during the California lockdowns. They weren't deemed essential, is the problem. And this church, it was Pastor Rob McCoy, noticed that the strip clubs were allowed to stay open, but the churches were closed. And so he put on this racy music Sunday morning, and he kind of shimmies out of his jacket like it's a striptease at Sunday morning church. Now, it ended with a jacket. So, you know, those who are a little bit mortified and a little more puritanical than the rest of us, breathe easy. He was making a point. He said, no, it's not a church anymore. It's a strip club. Now, I removed my jacket and I'm going to talk about Jesus for a while. And I'm like, that is so odd. Look at the descent. That's fantastic. So they got fined. They got threatened to be arrested. They had cops harassing them for a very long time, racked up hundreds of thousands of dollars of fines, but they stayed open while churches were closing like crazy around them. I'm like, man, where's the courage? Where's the righteous or as bold as lions? Refuse it. Do not give up meeting together. Some are in the habit of doing. Bible. And we totally just fearfully shut down, right? Like, okay, all right, yeah. Got to do that. You willing to be fined? You willing to lose a job? You willing to get a lesser grade in your college classes? I'll tell you, if I lead an organization called the Warrior Poet Society. We're always hiring folks. A liberal arts degree doesn't really mean a lot to me. I'm like, okay, that probably means that you're woke, entitled, and have no idea what bathroom to use. That's immediately, your liberal arts degree might be a mark against you when I'm evaluating whether to hire you or not. True story. But if I found out that you got a bad grade because you took a principal stand against leftism, I'm like, yep. You can work here. I'll actually work for you. That sounds great. Sounds fantastic. I miss courage so much. And I recognize cowardice is spreading like wildfire. We're all afraid and we're bullied. And I know that cowardice spreads, but you know, courage does too. Disobedience will mean personal pain for you, and you have to decide right now whether you're ready to endure that. And really, your ability to endure that, when that moment of truth comes, is all going to come down to courage. It's always courage. It's always been about that. It always has been. And I get that it's hard. I've certainly been everywhere on the scale of courage, from hero to coward. When I was a young teenager, maybe I was like 12 or 13, I went to Six Flags over Georgia. It's like roller coasters and stuff. And I'm getting in the scream machine, and this doesn't even have like loops or anything, but I was scared. Don't judge me. Y'all promise me you won't judge me?
Sure.
Yeah, sure. He's like, sure, which means I'm judging you hard already. I see you, bro. I see you. Maybe I deserve this because I totally chickened out and all the bars were down on the roller coaster. I'm like, no, I went out. And then the bars came up and I got out, and then like all these folks I got there with, guys and girls, well, went off and to be courageous. And I'm just kind of like, I suck. I had to nurse that for a while. Yep, I'm John Lovell. I chickened out on the scream machine many years ago. Still haven't walked that off as a man. my story didn't end there. I ended up getting into wrestling. I've been fighting most of my life in one way or another. After wrestling, I went into military and special operations. I went on 5 different combat tours to Iraq and Afghanistan, jumped out of airplanes and helicopters and done all kinds of stuff. Been in some gunfights and whatnot. And I guess I just say all that to say I had to learn something about courage. I had to learn that it's a choice. I had to learn that it wasn't some special class of people where, I'm afraid they're them and they're bigger than life and they can do it because they're them. Surely it hits them different, and it doesn't. I remember jumping out of an airplane for the first time. Well, the first time doesn't count. I had to go to the bathroom so bad for my first jump out of an airplane. I didn't care. I was ready to move soldiers. I'm like, go, listen, let me bum out. I have the need to pee. I had to go. And so the first jump didn't count because I had no fear. If you have to go to the bathroom bad enough, you are not afraid of anything except not finding a toilet. That's it. That's all I was afraid of. The second jump, though, was scary. You know, and then every Bible verse I can think of is coming to mind. You have to really summon it, and then you have to. Courage is hard, and it always comes down to courage, right? And courage, as we're talking about courage, where it comes from, it is a decision that happens in the act, but it's also an outgrowing of your faith, and it's a testing of your value. Some people think courage is a value. Courage is not. C.S. Lewis would say, courage is the testing point of every virtue at its breaking point, right? So if you, for instance, had the opportunity to lie and kind of get your butt out of trouble. Maybe it's the classic, hey, honey, does this dress make me look fat? Like, oh. No, you look great. Maybe. You look great. Well, here's a moment where I get to test of like, all right, let's just say the dress is not flattering and you're lovely, honey. Babe, she's watching at home, baby. You're beautiful. Awesome. All your dresses are great. Except that one. You totally look like a cow in that one. Just kidding. But here I'm faced with a dilemma of what do I value more? A lonely night or truth telling? I come face to face with it, you know? I start breaking out in a sweat. I'm like, do I value truth more? And hopefully you can find some diplomatic way out of it. And right now all you guys are fishing of like, how about you say this? And you come out with some way to thread that line. And I'm like, I get that. But the moral conundrum thereof is it all right to tell just a little white lie to kind of save my butt right there? What if it's just okay to be quiet? How much do you value truth, right? When you're scared. And so when you push your love of truth to the absolute limit where you're terrified, that's where you bump into courage, and insert every single other virtue there. Say that you are afraid to get shot and killed by some active killer. Active killer comes in here and everybody rushes away from the door because we don't have guns in D.C. to defend ourselves with. And 96% of all violent encounters happen in gun-free zones because they like to shoot fish in a barrel. But anyway, we all back away and I'll say, okay, do I charge that guy? If I do, I'm going to catch a bullet, right? But let's say my kids are there. Let's say you're there. Let's say that I'm a great lover of people. And perfect love casts out all fear from 1 John. And so I rush that shooter because I'm saying, no, I'll trade me for them. And it's not that I'm being brave here. It's that I love so ferociously that I don't feel that fear, right? And so that's where the courage element is overcome. Your virtue was strong and so courage followed. Much of our cowardice is because we're not actually good people. We don't have hearts full of faith. The righteous are as bold as lions. I advise get as close to Jesus as you can, and you will fear not. And that's good advice. Amen. Yep. Speaking of, there was a young lawyer in the 1500s by the name of Martin Luther. He had a near photographic memory. He was an awful guy to debate in like a courtroom. The other side would show up with all like these books up and Martin Luther would just be chilling on himself. He had like a photographic memory. So this guy was just wicked bright, had a wonderful future ahead of him, and he'd just toast everybody. It was amazing. But he was terrified of lightning storms. And one day Martin Luther gets caught out in the open in a lightning storm and he just freaks out and he basically falls down and says, God, if you save me, I'll become a monk. And God did, and Martin Luther did. And so he becomes a monk, right? And so here's Martin Luther, terrified of lightning storms, so much so that he throws all of his hopes and dreams and the disapproval of his dad, all that comes to bear, and he becomes a monk because he was just terrified of lightning. So before you judge me about the roller coaster thing, I'm like, Martin Luther, great guy, lightning. Roller coaster's kind of scary. I don't know which is scarier, but either way, he lost his man card that day. You know? But he had a chance to redeem it. In 1517, he'd nail his famous 95 Theses on the door of a church in Wittenberg. That would be basically the catalyst, the start to what we call the Protestant Reformation. It's when the world got its Bible back, which had been missing for hundreds of years. Fantastic. Yep, history is great. History is great. Catholic, you got get out of here. Get out of here. These guys are like, boo, Martin Luther. Hey, it's a good story, though. It's a good story. Anyway, I'm doing the courage thing, you know? I'm doing the courage thing because this took guts. He was summoned by Papal Bull to see all the archbishops at the Diet of Worms, and he's basically interviewed there, and he recognized this could be horrible, horrible consequences, pain and death kind of thing, if he doesn't renounce all the things that he has written and said. And basically, he had to summon up every bit of courage that God would give the grace to give him so he could say, you know what, to violate your conscience and disobey as he sees the scriptures is neither good or safe. Here I stand. I can do no other. He got his man card back that day, you know. It's kind of like that was courage in the face, but it was virtue on fire. That won it for him. Freedom from tyrants means disobedience. Disobedience means personal pain. Personal pain will not be paid if you don't have courage. You won't have courage if you don't have virtue. And if enough of us experience that personal pain, future generations might be free. We're on a tipping point. And I was thinking of this as I'm just walking through downtown Washington, D.C. today, of just how all empires throughout history would decay ever so slowly. And as it gets toward the very twilight, when it gets toward the end, things speed up radically. Things start breaking apart. Do you feel a breaking apart? A destruction of the underpinnings? Maybe America continues on, but it's not 1776 America. That would have died somewhere. 2018, 2014, 2024. We have no idea when historians will mark the tombstone of when America died. Maybe it's already died, according to some historians. Maybe it's not going to die for years to come. But make no mistake, we are getting so far from our foundation, so far from the original declarations of our moral base. I don't know that we can survive it. But if we can, it would be because enough individuals, you and you and you and me, go through enough personal pain that says, no more. Here's my line, tyrants. Come at me. I'm not moving. You know? When tyrants make rules that disregard our constitutional founding or the laws of man, I get to just kind of say, hey, up yours. I'm not going to do that. And there's going to be horrible consequences to that. Will you pay those with me?
Hell yeah.
I'm going to open up to questions. Before I do so, I want to end with a quote by Nelson Mandela. It says, when a man is denied the right to live the life he believes in, he has no choice to become an outlaw. So here's to you, my courageous and virtuous fellow outlaws, right? Let's do the question thing. None of you Catholics. You Catholics, no questions right there. People online would be like, what do you have again? I'm messing with you. You don't mess with people that you like, you know? I like these guys. Hey, what's happening?
Hi, I'm Ella Johnson. I'm from Utah Valley University. Thanks for your speech. I really enjoyed it. As I'm trying to process, I think of radical people today that assume this courageous attitude, like radical feminists or these people that are rioting in the streets. And then I think of far right wingers who have like ruined relationships with people over petty things because they're so stubborn. So I guess my question is, how do we not only have courage, but clarity in what it is we need to be courageous for? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. One problem with progressivism is it's progressed in the wrong direction. You know, we have certain unalienable truths. It's enshrined in our Constitution, the right to life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. And by looking with the benefit of hindsight, which is more 2020, throughout all the collective wisdom for centuries and centuries, we can understand what ideals are good and hold the test of time, and then radical ones which contradict the thing you signed up for as Americans, right? It's our Constitution. That's what makes us Americans. It's not race or sexual orientation or any other little thing you want to make it. It's that we are all one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We're committed to the Constitution. That's it. We're an ideals-based community. And so when somebody radically stands opposed to that, that's not an American ideal, and you can go be radical and be crazy somewhere else. There's plenty of other places to do that. And so we have enshrined a roadmap, a basis, a foundation. If you don't like the foundation, leave. You know, it's kind of that simple. All of our prima donna actors will come out of like, I'm moving to whatever, and they never move because they know this is like a really great place to live. Anyway, does that answer your question?
Yeah.
That's good. Awesome.
So.
Great. Thank you. What's up, man?
I recently returned from missionary service in South Korea, and since that time, I've thought a lot about how I should involve myself politically and how should I engage politically. And I really have thought a lot about what you said, that we're not that good if, you know, we don't act on the things we believe. And I think it's really easy to kind of fall into this trap where, like, you believe in the Second Amendment and you believe in defending it, but it's easy not to actually act on those things. And
yeah.
I guess, how do you remain complacent? Or how do you prevent yourself and also encourage others to not remain complacent in that way?
Great. Well, one is conversations, knowledge share, it's idea transfer, which is what we're doing here. That's the first piece. If we can't get our minds wrapped around something right, then our actions are not going to follow suit. But one thing is I'm forced when it comes to gun laws to make a weird decision of like, the Second Amendment says that there's that a government should make no law that infringes upon the right of the people to keep and bear arms. Yet we have all these laws that do infringe upon it. And since the Constitution is the highest law of the land, that means any lesser law that contradicts it, I can just say, kick rocks. I'm going to do what I want. And then I do what I want. And so one is we speak and do things. And then the next thing is I go and do what I want, which may upset a lot of people. And I don't really care. And then if you suck at concealment, people find out. If you're good at concealment, nobody's ever going to know until it's time to shoot somebody. And they're like, whoa, you shot him. I'm like, yeah, he's a bad guy. And you're like, rock on. And so I just do whatever I want because I recognize, oh, gun-free zone. It's like, no. Active killers hunt in gun-free zones exclusively. I would rather you flush all the gun-free zone signs, carry anyway. Don't be bad at concealment. Hide it, you know? And then if people come in to shoot innocents, then you kill them for it. That'd be great. Y'all can tell I'm not a politician. He's like, yeah, that's a soldier. Yeah. Yeah, if you want to kill kids, I want to kill you for it. Yeah.
Hi, Mr. Lovell. My name is Stephen from University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. So thank you for talking to us tonight. Today, my question is, do you believe using our guns to protect our rights against tyrannical government is a resort to violence? And how do you balance between disobedience and insurrection?
Great. So don't shoot first. Don't shoot first. Here's my hard stops. Because one, it's like, I got a bunch of buddies who are really, really good cops. They're not going to come institute a gun seizure for me, but there's others that absolutely would. I'm not ready to kill cops for that. You know, of like, I'll bury my guns. I'll hide my guns. I'm not, whatever I do, I'm not giving them up. I'll never give away my guns. I'm keeping those, right? But I believe in the process of law. I believe still in voting. I believe in petitioning our government according to the First Amendment. I don't want everyone to take up arms. That's not what I mean. Let's engage in the battle of ideas through our legislative processes to win our freedoms back. But when they start shooting at me, I get to shoot back. And so that's my answer. But no, I want peaceful resistance and dissension. And that's what I'm talking about today. You.
Awesome. Mr. Lovell, thank you for being here today and giving this speech. It was really amazing, so thank you. Thanks. For doing that. But my name is Justin Sharp. I'll be attending Oklahoma State University here in about 3 weeks. But my question to you is, we live in a country where there's two very different visions of what our history are, what our future is, and who we are in our heart and soul. And my question to you is, do you find that disobedience or conversation to try to bring those two visions together is more effective?
I don't think those are mutually exclusive. I would love conversation. Absolutely. Just the point is when my opposition disagrees with me, they don't get to impress their viewpoint on me or cancel me or modify my behavior. They're like, hey, we disagree on an issue, and because I disagree, you have to do what I say. I'm like, no, we discuss, but then you may disobey me, right? And so that's basically what I'm talking about, is saying I serve a moral law that is higher than my legal one. And that's basically what my speech is about.
Hi, my name is Isabella Dini. I go to the University of Alabama. So I feel like a lot of conservatives are very quick to defend the private sector and private businesses, but more and more it seems like private businesses are infringing upon our constitutional rights. And I'm not just talking about big tech. I recently graduated from a secular high school, and it was definitely a character-building experience. And I'm wondering, what do you think is the best way to, I'm not sure if balance is the right word, but balance the rights of private businesses with individual citizens?
Very good question. I'll say it's a bit above my pay grade. Companies like big tech, those are public corporations, right? But I would say that, all right, I see a lot of problems with big tech censorship. We've got a pretty large YouTube channel. We're also on all social media outlets. I'm constantly discriminated against and shadow banned. And I feel that friction. And what I would like to do the lesser impulse in me. It was like, hey, somebody make them be right and do the right thing, you know? If like that's part of the impulse. But then I'm like, wait, who's going to keep them in check? Oh, government. And so I have to ask the government to come in and give them the most powerful surveillance tool the world has ever known, the backdoor keys to big tech, and the government's gonna regulate that? I'm like, ugh. The problem is on this fallen rock we call Earth, we have to choose between lesser evils, and I'd rather have companies in charge than the government in charge. As much as big tech, it really hates me. We don't get along very well together. I don't trust the government with their information. I don't think the government has a right to seize that. However, big tech is engaging in illegal discrimination, and discrimination laws should be enforced by the government for them. But government shouldn't take over those platforms. You see the thing? Cool.
Thank you.
We've got time for one more question.
Hey, nope. Sir, thanks.
Last question, make it great.
I will try my best.
You need a moment? Let them think.
First and foremost, thank you for your service to our great country.
Sure thing.
Really appreciate it.
The USA crowd, you guys are awesome. You know that like gets me pumped up, so you do it anyway. You're like, let's get them roused up again. I'm like, yeah, you guys are great.
That was awesome. Anyways, my name is Jay Elias. I go to George Washington University down the street. On the side, I'm a volunteer fireman, and similar to your work, when it comes to saving lives, it doesn't matter what the person on the other side looks like. So how, as young people, could we work together to bring the message to heal the division across the country?
Well, very good. I would love to be able to heal that division. It absolutely just breaks my heart what my country has become. I was just at the National Museum of American History, and I was looking at the 1812 flag that flew over Fort McHenry. And it's the same one, I was seeing the actual flag, that Francis Scott Key saw when he wrote the Star Spangled Banner. And I saw that flag and I wept. I love my country and I am broken to see it divided. The problem with reconciling to the opposition is it takes two to reconcile. And I'm reasonable and I am open to reconciliation. And you can insult me and yell at me and disagree with me and call me a fascist, because they've ruined the word fascist, by the way. Everything's a fascist, you know? Fascist, when they just don't just yell fascist at me, but call me fascist and Hitler and canceling us. Of like, typically they don't have conservative friends. They think we're super evil. And I don't know, I see a lot of that from the left. And I see a lot of people in between that are very open to just good, engaging conversation. So there's some folks that we can gain unity through just open conversation, through just being kind and polite, through understanding, through just being sober-minded and clear by showing that you're not the caricature that the media would paint you as. You're not radical crazies, you're just family, patriotic, you want good for the country, you kind of want people to stop doing the tyranny stuff to you and just kind of leave you alone, you know, like you're reasonable folks. And the other side, some of them don't really see that. You cannot reconcile with the viewpoints that are so hostile that they are not open to reason. They'll shout you out so that they're not interested in hearing from you. So you can't force a reconciliation when another party will not reconcile. There's a lot of people in between. I think you seek division with, or you seek unity with those folks. Leave the left to destroy themselves. The left is eating itself right now. It will destroy itself. It's happening right now. And that's a good thing. So you just let them burn themselves out. Let them be crazier and crazier. Because the game is, it's just constantly one up to be crazier and crazier and more insane. And we just kind of get to sit back and eat popcorn and watch it all burn to the ground. You know, that's, yeah. All right, very good. Guys, we have 14 seconds left. So why don't you say we chant some USA and I'll leave the stage. Sound good? Ready? And
USA! 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 USA!